So stitches came out, bleeding stopped, and I've still got it to this day. You're listening to the Beat Motel podcast, and we need to warn you that we like to use words like fuck, shit, anarcho-syndicalist, boxy scruttox, angry flap, and filth biscuits. And we don't often bleep those words out, apart from because we're not complete animals. But if you understand that and you like music, then listen on. You're back with Beat Motel Music Podcast. We promise it's about music this week. We always say it's about music, but end up talking about any old crap. Dr. Sam is off excavating something somewhere. So I have a guest, a first-time co-host on the Beat Motel Podcast. Would you like to introduce yourself?
Oh, hello. I'm David Jago. I haven't done a podcast before. So
it's really difficult and really challenging.
I'm going to be talking crap, I'm afraid. It's not all just going to be music.
Have you heard this podcast? You'd be fully on brand for that.
Excellent.
Right. So I know Dave. I know David Jago. Jago. I should know that. It sounds like I don't know you. Especially, what's more embarrassing, before we started recording, I did actually ask you to reiterate how to say your name. But I know you as that bloke from loads of bands locally.
Yeah.
Mostly around Bury St. Edmunds, would that be fair?
Yeah, I thought you were going to say mostly awful ones.
Mostly terrible bands. last night we had a rehearsal in a band with each other.
Yeah, it was good fun.
Which was cool, yeah. So I'm gonna keep that under wraps for now, because it's like we're still in the chrysalis, I think. We're not ready to shed our scales and
I felt in quite a good mood when I woke up after smashing the drums last night. It's sort of therapeutic, isn't it?
Oh, you certainly look like you're enjoying it. I got home and I found out that Mark Cavendish is now, he won a tour at the Tour de France, and he's now won more Tour de France stages than any other human being who's ever lived. And that made me feel good as well. So I kind of went to bed with a double whammy. It was good. Right, let's crack off with your riff of the week. And it's this. That is beautiful. Who's that?
Soundgarden. And that's the 4th of July.
Because what's the date today, Jago?
The 4th of July. did you notice the bass in that as well?
That bass is just beautiful. So low. It's Ben so Shepherd, grindy.
And Ben Shepherd always plays something you don't quite expect. He's a really interesting bass player.
Soundgarden, I ought to do an episode on a list of bands I know I'm going to get into at some point, because... Soundgarden are one of those bands that I know they're dearly loved by so many people, and they've got so many really positive things going for them. When I say positive, I mean entirely subjectively the type of things I like in music, but I haven't yet connected with them. I've seen them live. I saw them with like Motorhead, Soulfly, and Black Sabbath. And to be honest, from that lineup on that day, if you had played me that riff and said which of these bands is that, I would have said Soulfly.
Right, okay.
I would have said, right, well, it sounds a bit Sepultura-y, very detuned, very low. But no, I was well surprised that was Soundgarden. I think, like maybe some people, I know them from Black Hole Sun and not a lot else.
Yeah, they describe themselves as a cross between Black Sabbath and the Beatles. So there's a kind of a sense of there's a real melody there all the time. And there's a real keen sense of heaviness. Matt Cameron on drums is absolutely superb, because they do so many different time signatures. And you're kind of oblivious to it, because it's like it's incidental. They just happen to be musical geniuses, but they've got really good songs, which is, I really like that. You know,
so if somebody had to describe them to me at any point in the last 35 years they've been around as Black Sabbath crossed with the Beatles, I would have listened to them. That would have been enough. So if I had known you all that time ago, we might now be here talking about all the Soundgarden albums in very deep detail.
Sleeper Unknown is I think is a masterpiece, and it's It's one of those albums, when I put it on, if I'm on shuffle or something and one of the songs comes on, I have to listen to the whole album. I have to just take it off shuffle and listen to the whole thing and then go back to the start and listen to it, you know.
It's a perfect album. Huge. Then, one where each song flows into each song in the right time.
And it's like the song Black Hole Sun on its own is really good, but within the context of the album is even better because of the way it, the way it introduces itself and it's just the way it sits within the context of the album is really nice. Yeah.
So the Soundgarden, I've sort of lumped them probably quite unkindly in with a lot of bands who sort of rose to prominence or got a bit of a foot up through grunge.
Yeah.
And then like Pearl Jam very quickly kind of went, no, we're about much more than that, which is a fucking smart thing to do. Because any band that gets trapped in a genre, hey, there's a little hint.
Hey, there we go.
Any band that gets trapped in a genre, especially in the UK, where the enemy would like invent a genre and then kill it after 6 months. So, yes, but having heard that from Soundgarden and heard a few other things that you've said, I don't see how they were connected to grunge in any way at all.
Really, I mean, they kind of created that sound. I mean, them and, I mean, Temple of the Dog was a mixture of Pearl Jam and Soundgarden. And that's really the beginnings of that type of sound. And I think mainly that's because of the vocals. And everyone else started sort of singing a bit like Cher, you know, so that sort of vocal stuff. But they did that originally, you know, so they kind of created that.
I can see one sort of slightly tenuous link with Nirvana is that for human beings of our experienced chronological development,
old people,
music and especially metal was fucking horrible largely in the late 80s. The production got so clean and got so it was a complete pop. I mean, there's a brilliant documentary about like hair metal, and somebody in Poison, they say, well, so what happened when Nirvana came along? And the guy just sort of goes crestfallen and is like, well, that was the end of it.
Yeah.
So but one of the things that, and it wasn't, of course, it wasn't just Nirvana, it was loads and loads and loads of bands. But one of the things they did was just break off what had become quite a cheesy metal trope of the whoa and all that shit and the hair and just going back to be kind of filthy. And that riff is filthy.
Yeah. And I never cared for Black. I never really cared for Black Sabbath. It's never been a band I've liked. That's the weird thing.
For me, there's a lot of bands who I'm like, yeah, they're important. Don't particularly like them. I'm going to probably lose a load of listeners, but I think Black Sabbath are a good best of band. My bandmate Rocky put together a best of, I was going to say tape playlist for me, and it started with Aeronaut. It's called Aeronaut. Sorry. The riff that goes, and I was like, hey, that's cool. And then by the end of it, I was like, that was a satisfying best of, and I've never really dug much deeper than that.
Yeah, I'm like that with a few bands where I think, I quite like this, and then and it's just such a personal thing, isn't it? It's not right or wrong. I mean, Led Zeppelin are like that for me. I used to listen to Led Zeppelin a bit, and I just never felt drawn back to it. And I've got the How the West Was Won album. Sometimes I put that on, and I'll be like, wow, this sounds amazing. And then I'll just go, I can't be bothered anymore, and turn it off. There's something about it that it's almost too much. I just can't. And if you don't connect with it, it's just how it is, isn't it? You can't.
I spoilt myself in two ways with Led Zeppelin. First of all, when I was about 18 and 19, got too obsessed. And I always say, apart from the last two albums, got too obsessed and got to the point where the sound of it just made me feel sick. I was so fed up with it. And then they got ruined again for me about a year ago when I read a book called Hammer of the Gods, which is about them as individuals. And I'd say, apart from John Paul Jones and Robert Plant, who sound kind of quite nice.
Yeah.
I think John Bonham, deeply troubled, quite emotionally simple person who just wanted to be at home and dealt with that in very bad ways. And then Jimmy Page, I think, was just not a very nice person.
I don't mind that, though. That wouldn't put me off, really.
So you can separate the art from the artist.
Yeah, but in a weird sort of way, if I'm to find out that an artist is really right-wing or they're, you know, a bit of a Nazi or something, it doesn't put me off. It almost fascinates me a bit more. I sort of want to know the story behind it a little bit. Whereas if they're, it's like when Tom York talks about politics, I just think, shut up, just stop talking about politics, because I don't want to know. I'd almost rather he was sort of. He just kept it to himself, or was like a secret bigot, or something a bit weird. Do you know what I mean?
I wish Tom York was a secret bigot.
Yeah, but that's like, it's a bit more enigmatic, isn't it? But him sort of, it's like when Corbyn was out and he was sort of pro Corbyn. I just thought, I'll just leave it out. Just he's saying all the left wing stuff that people want to hear, and I just think I'm not interested in that. I'd rather it become something challenging there, you know.
Yeah, no, I can see that. That's an interesting perspective, and also it. It's one of those things with some bands and some genres, it's a part of the aesthetic. So, yeah. You know, I love sort of anarcho bands like Subhumans and that kind of ilk. And yeah, absolutely expect them to talk about politics. I kind of want their opinion on it. It doesn't mean I always agree with it. But someone like Radiohead, I'm like, it doesn't really add anything.
No, and I sort of want the enigma. I sort of want Tom York to be this weird enigma that I don't know anything about.
The enigma thing I like, and I love all music documentaries and books, but sometimes I question why I read them, because breaking the enigma can spoil it. So
absolutely.
Always love the charlatans. So reading Tim Burgess's book and finding out he was a crackhead, for some reason that was quite a shock to me. I was like, really? Yeah. Really? Right. Ought to go on for my riff of the week now, and it's this one. That was, do you want to have even a rough guess at who that was?
It made my nose bleed. I don't know.
It's a band called Spitfire. It's a slightly odd choice. I was thinking about, when I sat down to prepare this episode, I thought, riffs. What riffs were perhaps formative on me at a young age? Because I guess that Soundgarden must be, is that early 90s?
94.
4th of July?
94. Superunknown, yeah.
Okay, so this band, that riff, band Spitfire, that might have been about 92, 93, the song Wild Sunshine. And I saw them supporting Blur at the UEA when Blur must have been on their first album tour, probably, or second. No, first, because no one went to go and see them on their second album tour. No. We saw them in tiny venues. And they probably the first band I'd seen live that scared me a little bit, which is something I now really like in bands.
Crave, yeah.
Because they came on, yeah, I don't think there's enough of it generally. They came on and all black leather trousers, leather jackets, black t-shirt, all black, long hair, and the singer just stared at a fixed point in the crowd. And the guitarist was staring at me and a friend, because we were kids, we were at the front getting crushed. And he just had this fixed stare, did no expression at all while he was sort of shredding in a very weird garage rock kind of style on the guitar. And there was another guy who looked like Joey Ramone. His only job was go chick, 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 on this SG. And then the drummer was just kind of cool. And I can remember it was the first time I'd seen a band and gone, I'm a little afraid.
Intimidated.
But I like it. I'm a little intimidated.
Nice. Oh, it's nice to be intimidated. By enigmatic musicians, I think. Yeah. That's a very 90s, that's an extremely 90s sound, isn't it? It's almost a bit baggy, isn't it, in a sense?
It's funny, listening back to it, I wholly agree. At the time, early on in my musical education, as it were, I hadn't really heard a lot of garage, you know, American garage rock, and I assumed that they would sound like that, but with kind of 70s guitar noodling over it. But you're right, there is quite a... There is quite a baggy sound to that. Baggy.
I wonder if that sense of sort of being intimidated by musicians has sort of gone a little bit, because everyone's so nice now, aren't they? You have to be really nice now. Unless you've got to the point where you're successful and you can be controversial, like John Lydon or Morrissey, where they can say anything and they've got such a following that people will just enjoy it. If you're vaguely controversial now, I think... people just get almost blacklisted, or Or labeled as something, you know, unlistenable or to be avoided.
It's a challenging thing because as somebody who's put on a lot of bands, if a band are dicks, I won't put them on again. It's really straightforward. Yeah. And I have done that. There was a band that was on the up, doing quite well years ago now. And the drummer ended up coming up to go, "Are you some sort of fucking moron?" When I just asked him a really basic question, I was like, "Well, go ahead and play, but you know, come here and treat me like shit. I'm not going to book you again." Yeah. But then there's some bands who manage to walk a line of being scary but not alienating. And there's a couple of bands that played Bright in the Corners last year, not this year. And my bandmate does the sound in one of the venues, and there's a band called Dits, and they came on, and I was like, "Whoa, I'm intimidated by this band." The singer came on, really tall, wearing like a nightie, and they were in the crowd quite early on, and obviously not attacking anyone, but really like just snaring, just sort of staring at people, and the tension in the room was quite palpable, but brilliant, and everyone was really into it, and then. So I asked my friend, I said, "Well, what were they like?" And he said, "They were lovely." Yeah. So they're absolutely lovely people.
Well, that's the point, isn't it? I think there's almost a theatrical element to it. And I almost think like the controversy. I think the controversy is often that as well. It doesn't mean I don't think that necessarily means being disrespectful to people, but there's something about that that's almost quite fascinating. Characters, I suppose, you know, genuine characters. Whereas you have someone like Ed Sheeran who just has one facial expression and doesn't really want to offend anybody. I'm sure he's a lovely bloke, but I don't feel drawn to him. I don't feel like I want to know anything about him really, because he just seems like just someone that you'd just meet, you know.
You've made me think that the fear of being cancelled, and I think that's a load of bullshit. I don't think that's really a thing. The fear of being cancelled, if you were in the 90s and you were a band and you relied heavily on your label and your manager as your conduit between people who liked you and yourself, then you could fuck up massively and your career would be over. You know, your agent wouldn't speak to you anymore and then your name's mud throughout the industry. But surely now bands should have a longer, more leeway, say a longer leash, that's not what I mean at all.
I think because it's if you've built to get past that line though, isn't it? I mean, if you think 30 years ago, if you got on MTV, or maybe 35 years ago, if you got on MTV, that was it. You'd be in a stadium in a month or so. Do you know what I mean? You suddenly got shot to absolute stardom. And I don't know if there's that route now where you can just explode into fame. I think it's better now in the sense that it's more evenly spread out, that anybody can release anything. But I don't think you have that massive fame now in that sense, you know.
You don't. I've heard Noel Gallagher talk about. Yeah, but there's no sort of longevity to that. I heard Noel Gallagher saying he thinks Oasis were one of the last bands to get that stratospheric and make hundreds of millions of pounds. He said it just doesn't exist now. But the security I would expect bands to have now is that if they've got their social media following, and if they were sensible enough to get those people on an email list, then you can take more of a chance, because even if the label drops you, you'll be like, "Well, okay, fuck you. I've got 400,000 people on a mailing list. I'll ask them to buy the next album."
Well, someone said there was someone I was talking to that said it's easier than ever to make a living out of music, but it's harder than ever to be famous. And that kind of stuck with me. That was the guy that puts the Chris that puts the Jam Nights on. He said that, and he works within.
Oh.
He's worked within the industry, isn't he? A little bit, you know him.
He absolutely has. God, I've known him for a long time. Yeah, he's been a professional musician, and he's done bucket list stuff. I bumped into him for the first time in years, and he said within 3 months he did Glastonbury, Jules Holland, and about five or six other things that he always wanted to do, just all at once. Right, we ought to get on.
Yeah, he knows what he's talking about, I guess.
Well, he knows the absolute reality. Right, we ought to get onto the theme, and the theme this week is one that you came up with. So would you like to share it?
Yeah, well, I think you gave me a list. These are the things, and you said it was one that was bands that grow. I think it was bands that grow.
Probably something like that flabby, probably.
And then I thought of something that I've talked about a bit, because I do live streams on my Instagram page, And it's about bands that outgrow their genre, or bands that disassociate themselves with the genre that they've been associated with so heavily, you know, or something like that. You know what I mean? So, yeah.
Well, as ever on this, on the Beat Motel podcast, the interpretation of the hosts always differs, and that's part of the joy of it. So let's kick this off with your first choice. Come with me. I would not have been able to guess who that was if you hadn't, well, obviously, if you hadn't sent me the list of tracks you wanted me to clip up ready. Who was that?
Clash. And that is off the Sandinista album. And I think it's not my... Sandinista isn't my favourite Clash album. Give Money for Rope is my favourite Clash album because it from start to finish, I think, is... It doesn't step a foot wrong. That's a bit like Super Unknown for me. It's like an album I listen to, and every song is an absolute classic for me. Sandinista, they just threw everything at it. I think it's a quadruple album, actually. I don't even think it's a triple album. I think it's quadruple. And it just goes everywhere. It just goes absolutely everywhere. And it's almost like... You can tell they're just enjoying that so much, just throwing, just everything, having guest singers on and just throwing everything at it. It's absolutely brilliant, you know.
Who is that singing? Because that sure as hell ain't your lad.
He's a folk singer from England.
Oh, Time and Doug.
That's yeah.
Who apparently was in Strummer's band, The 101ers, before The Clash.
Muscaleros, I think he was in.
Oh, okay.
Later on, yeah.
I'm always interested Sorry, go on.
It's sort of an awful vocal performance, you know, in terms of like singing, in terms of being a singer, but I like the delivery. I like the way he sounds like he's jumping up and down while he's singing. He sounds like he's really physically enjoying the experience of it. And it's just like, what is it? What genre is it? It's like country music. It's like the bass is doing some funk, and the arrangement's really nice. The melody's really nice. It just goes all over the place, and I don't know what it is. And I love that. I love not knowing what I'm listening to in that sense. You know, it's hugely enjoyable. I think.
I think this is such a good first choice to set up the theme for the episode, because The Clash, I would say, undoubtedly got signed in a panic signing with A&R men rushing out into London looking for punk bands.
Yeah.
And they absolutely are punk. You know, they are the very definition of punk to me, and that's going to upset a lot of people. But the songs like this make that more so to me, because the punk sound and the punk attitude are two entirely separate things. So first album, straight up punk.
That's right. To me, the first album is the least interesting. I sometimes put the first album on and I think this is playing to the punk stereotype, and I find it the least interesting in that sense. There's some good tunes on it, but on Give Them Enough Rope, the genres are all over the place, but it's quite a straight rock album. But the genres do go all over the place, and then they just went nuts, you know. And I think you're right, because I think... I do think about the idea of punk and what that means. And I sometimes think of it as, I mean, you can think of punk as the stereotype of that genre, which Green Day would become, for instance. Everything they're doing, Stiff Little Fingers have done before, it sounds like punk, you know. And then there's the other side of it, which I always think of as a celebration of adolescence. I guess I don't know whether that's my counsellor head thinking about that, but that's the kind of...
I should just say that, Jago's a counsellor, professionally.
I don't know whether that's my approach of it as well, is the sense that it's in many ways, it's a celebration of adolescence. It's that anti-establishment part of it, that sort of stroppy part of it. And it's almost like that could be seen as derogatory, but I don't think it is. I think there's a sense that that is to be celebrated. You stay in touch with your inner child. You stay in touch with those different stages of your life.
Finding yourself, isn't it?
Yeah.
When you're a tiny kid, you're just a blob.
So, yeah. And it's about identity. And I think that the original idea of punk, the original idea of everybody dressing differently, you know, the idea how originally they rip their clothes up. You see the original punks, they all look very different and all look very individualistic. And it's a celebration, and they're adolescents. And it's no different to the hippies, really, in that sense. Mm. But it's more aggressive. It's more, you know, trying to be heard, really trying to be heard. And then it became a uniform. And then it became, you have spiky hair, you wear certain types of leather jackets. And it became, stereotypical, I guess. But the attitude, like John Lydon then doing Peel, that's more punk. And I think Morrissey singing The Queen Is Dead, that to me is punk. That to me is a real sense. I mean, I think he ended up in court for that.
Oh, really?
No, yeah. And then he ended up. Strange. He ended up doing Margaret on the Guillotine. You know, and it's a ballad. It's a really, really sort of nice sort of ballad. But to me, that is really, you know, that is a punk aesthetic. That more so than the other bands at the time that went, okay, we'll just sound like the Sex Pistols forever. You know, that to me is the sound as opposed to the attitude, yeah.
So Clash are one of several bands who I really admire. There's a running joke on this podcast. I've never listened to a Clash album the whole way through, which sadly is true. But they're one of the bands I admire from this genre, this era, along with bands like Wire. And I'm going to say John Lydon because, yeah, Pill, fucking Flowers of Romance.
Yeah.
Going from Anarchy in the UK to Flowers in Romance in a very short period of time, like, just wow. And bringing Jar Wobble and Keith Levine into the world of
magnificent
of popular music, and then bizarrely Stevie Vai and Ginger Baker later on. Amazing.
That was the first one I had, the compact cassette, I think it was, actually the one that I had, that album.
Yeah, they're all different, really, when LP cassette and compact disc,
really interesting.
But Wire did the same thing, and Wire, I don't know much about Clash live, but I imagine Sandinista period Clash, if you saw them live, you probably would get some older songs.
Yeah.
It's pure guesswork. Whereas Wire have always had this thing of saying, we are not our own covers band. So they always refuse to play anything that's too many years old, which I think is kind of badass in a lot of ways. That's quite flying in the face of what people would traditionally do. You've got bands like the Rolling Stones who will release, but they've been this way for 25 years, but they'll release a new album. I can remember they released Bridges Over Babylon or whatever it was. Yeah. And famously, the reviews of that tour saying they didn't play a single song off it.
I mean, to be honest, I'd say that they've been that way for about 50 years or maybe pushing 50 years. If you think about it, I mean, Goat's Head Soup was probably the last of that wave of very good Rolling Stones albums. You know, there was a sort of a decade of very, very good Rolling Stones albums. And then it just went a bit like, you know, trying to sound like the Rolling Stones. And then it just became about celebrating that decade of material, I think, you know.
It's a complex thing. I do think, sticking with the Clash just for a little bit longer, I've read, you know, a bunch of stuff about the Clash, and they're definitely a band that if I see any article anywhere, I'll soak it up. I find them endlessly fascinating for many reasons.
They're very good musicians. That's the point. They're actually very good musicians. Very, you know, they play extremely well. You know, punk is often, there's a lot of punk bands that I think they play punk because they can't necessarily play anything else. I don't know whether that's a mean thing to say. And I know that the energy of it isn't necessarily about musicianship. And I'm not all about great musicianship, but there's something about the Clash. They did all those different genres because they could. They could do it, you know.
Their amount of talent made the recording studio a plaything. We can do what we want. Absolutely, which makes me think, I've just realized that their A&R, were they on Capitol? Whoever they were signed to, their A&R was either an A&R with incredible foresight or incredible tolerance. Mm. Because you know the label bosses would have been saying, give us another punk album. Give us another punk album. They're going, well, actually, we're going to do Sandinista, which is, I've just looked it up, it's a 3 LP set. And the label at the time would have been, right, okay, so double LPs sell for like 50% more than single LP, so triple LP. Yeah, yeah, we can put this out for $40. And the Clash were like, no, $9.99.
Yeah.
And I refuse to believe that a major label like Capitol would have taken a hit on that. It would have been the Clash who took a hit on that. You know, the major label would not have lost money.
I think they did. I don't think they made a lot. Yeah, I think that is true, actually, that they did take the hit on that.
But what an incredible document to leave in the world.
Mm. But I also think that they broke America with that album. I'm sure they did.
Like, oh, it was Sandinista.
Magnificent Seven, I think, was I'm sure that did all right over there because it was quite disco-y. So I think some of that stuff did quite well in the States. You know,
well, you've got sort of
Rock the Casbah was later, and that I think that was more poppy. I think Rock the Casbah did all right in the States, actually.
Is Sandinista the Clash album that's got some sort of proto hip hop bits on it?
This sort of like a dub reggae, massive dub reggae sections and stuff like that. It sort of goes everywhere, really. You know,
my daughter played me M.I.A. She said, oh, there's this song that's all over TikTok and it's got this like noise in it, like a gun being fired and then cocked. And she played it. And I remembered that MIA just used, a Clash song. I'm going to have to look that up because that has really bothered me. I just literally was talking about it last night. Straight to Hell. So she uses Straight to Hell, and it is literally, she pressed, it sounds like she pressed play on Straight to Hell, added a bit of an 808 kick to summon it up, and then rapped over, took the vocals off and used that. But it sounds cool. And I was thinking, how amazing that like a root, there's all these amazing roots back to the Clash. And I was saying to my girl that in the late 80s, early 90s, a lot of me and my friends, our route to the Clash was the Levi's jeans advert.
Oh, of course. Yeah, so yeah.
Should I stay or should I go on it? Yeah, and suddenly the Clash were like massive again. Mm. Very cool. Right. We've talked for way too I was going to say we've talked too long about the Clash. I don't think that's possible. But I am going to play my next choice and then I'm going to talk about it for a very brief period of time.
Okay.
Oh, do you know who that was?
No. Is that from the 90s as well? That sounds like the 90s.
It is from the 90s. And I really try with this podcast not to always like dip into my teenage years, but they are quite formative on our choices.
I'm stuck in the 20th century. I wouldn't worry about it.
Sorry, I saw a clip on I'll have to look at TikTok for work. There's a clip where in America they call the 20th century the 19th century. And there's this teenage girl with some cassette tapes goes, this is how people listen to music in the 19th century.
Oh, no. It makes you feel old. Yeah.
Yeah, but that was Ride. And the track is Seagull, which is the opening track off their first album.
They were quite influential, and Ride, weren't they?
They were huge. Mm. But because they were lumped into the shoegaze genre, which was not a good thing to have happened for them, I don't think. They sort of got dismissed. But when I listen to that first Ride album, that still gets me. It's scratchy and it's interesting and the guitars are just going off all over the place. Mm. And I find it bizarre that it's got the bass line from Taxman by the Beatles in it.
Yeah, I thought I recognised that from somewhere, yeah.
For a split second when I was preparing this episode, I was tempted to give you Seagull by Ride and then I was going to give you there's a jam song that uses the same...
what is it? Yeah, I was just thinking that there's a jam song,
and then obviously Taxman by the Beatles. Well, I thought no, I won't. But I chose this because Ride fully lumped in as being shoegaze, and that first album, it's not what I think of shoegaze now. But by the second album already, they were pushing the boundaries. By the third album, they sounded nothing like it, and their last couple of albums, which I've not listened to in full, but the bits I've heard of it. Certainly are not in that genre. They're not just they've not done that thing where some people who break through in a genre then sort of become beige and just turn into classic rock. They've not done that. They're still doing really interesting things, which is interesting to me, partly because Andy Bell, the guitarist, was in Oasis for 20 years.
Yeah.
So when that came to an end, they've gone back to Ride, but actually picked it up again.
So they're still
carried
going
on progressing.
They're still playing now, are they?
Oh yeah, I mean they're still they're not massive, but well,
have you seen them?
My band. What's that?
Have you seen them live?
Not recently. I really want to. They're playing places like the UEA in Norwich, which I guess is what 800 capacity.
You saw them back in the day.
Sadly, not. I had a VHS tape of them playing at Brixton Academy, which I pretty much wore out and became. That's the reason I like music. Stingray. Music Man Stingrays, the bassist, used one, and they had those big old massive Rickenbackers.
Right, yeah.
The 360s or 330s, the like the really sexy curvy one rather than like Beatles style one. Right, so yeah, I'm literally just going to stop it there on Ride because gloriously we're halfway through this episode and we've got loads more, and this is your next one. Who is that?
Radiohead.
I have got to listen to Radiohead.
That's off Amnesiac. And there's a song called Spinning Plates. And I'm going to try and explain this. It's a song off the next album in reverse with different lyrics over the top. And he sings the lyrics in over the top of it backwards so that when it's played forward the lyrics play forward like Twin Peaks, and then there's a live album. So the three things to listen to is on Hail to the Thief there's I Will, which is this song forwards, and there's a live version of Like Spinning Plates on a live album which is called I Might Be Wrong, and he plays Spinning Plates straight on a piano. So he's playing a song in reverse on piano, and it's worth listening to those three together. And there's other sort of different mashups of it online and stuff. And I just think it's for me, that's the peak of Radiohead because it's the point where they were so creative on Kid A and Amnesiac. I count them as, I mean, it's essentially a double album. They were released slightly apart, but they're essentially the same body of work, you know.
Now people were calling Amnesiac Kid B at the time.
Yeah, essentially they've released it as Kid Amnesia now, which is the full thing, you know. And for me it's just the peak of Radiohead. I mean the reason they are suitable for what we're talking about is because they were associated with, I guess, alternative rock. You would say there was sort of alternative rock indie. I think I've even seen them on a Britpop compilation album. Do you know what I mean? I mean, that's ridiculous, but I think they were lumped in with a lot of those bands like Oasis and Blur and all of that lot. And then they went and did OK Computer, which is, you know, when you've done an album which is regarded as one of the greats, do you know what I mean? It's like up there with the Beatles and Marvin Gaye and all those sort of top albums that are always in the, you know, lists of albums. And then where'd you go from there, you know? And they did Kid A and Amnesiac. And I just think it's such a magnificent just collection where they just, for me, that's the peak of what they did ever, you know?
What album was Pyramid Song on?
That was on Amnesiac, yeah.
That was the one with Radiohead, because I was such a snobby teenager around music. I was so elitist, and I disregarded Radiohead because they had a hit single. They had Creep, which blew up huge in America, and then when the Bends came out, I can remember being on a caravan holiday with friends in a Lowestoft, and the Bends had come out, and my friend Jenny said, "You've got to listen to this. This is something really interesting." And I can remember going, this is interesting because they had the hit in America, sort of marginal hit in the UK. The label again would have gone, another one of them, please.
Yeah.
And they didn't. They sort of shifted a bit. And then OK Computer came out, and as you said, was just huge, unbelievably big. And again, I sort of lost interest in them, kind of going, oh, they're just a big, massive band. Or I couldn't disregard OK Computer, and still can't, because it is fucking brilliant.
It is amazing.
Genuinely fantastic. But then I can remember exactly where I was. I was driving through Rendlesham, and Pyramid Song came on the radio, and I felt like I was going to have to stop the car because I was so shocked.
Yeah.
How wild it was. That crazy time. I don't know if it's a crazy time signature or whatever, but the drums
technically I think it is in 4/4, but there's a lot of interesting time signatures on that album.
That's one of those things that makes me want to spend more time recording and want to spend time creating things without a definite aim. Have you seen the Beastie Boys documentary on Apple TV?
No, I've not.
Again, another band I don't really know much about, and I'm only now discovering, along with Radiohead. I'm a bit late. It's basically a recording of a stage show. They did a tour, the two of them who left, just talking about talking about being in the Beastie Boys. And their second album was such a massive flop that they knew that the label was contractually obligated to put out the next album, and the label gave them a budget to record it, and they just went, chuck it all out the door. You know, chuck everything that we've ever done before. And they spent a year in a studio just turning up, like doing 9-to-5 days and just recording and playing every single day until they'd created something they thought was good. And I think out of any sort of aspirations that I might have had as a teenager of playing stadiums or being in a big band, these days my aspiration is to do that.
Yeah.
What are you doing today? Making music. Who's going to listen to it? Couldn't give a shit.
Yeah.
You know, just don't care.
Yeah, you have to please yourself, and that's kind of it, really. If you start thinking about other people's ears, it doesn't really make sense because you don't know how it's going to be received, I guess, unless you're talking from a business perspective. But why would you want to make something that appeals to other people and not yourself? Because then you get trapped in a loop, wouldn't you? You see bands playing the same songs for 30 years and it just seems like hell. It seems like it must be hell on earth, you know. But I always think, like with Radiohead, it's like that again. With Radiohead, the first album is the one that I never listened to. I don't mind it, but it's the one that interests me the least.
It's just an indie band, though.
They start their career on, I think it's a 7/4. The first song on the first album is in 7/4, so it's a little bit of a sense of, okay, there's something a bit different about Radiohead. But,
so, listeners, if you can't tell, Jago is a drummer.
Yeah, but I don't know. I'm not a music theory person or anything like that. But I do sort of play in different time signatures. But like, they did My Eye and Lung on the Bends, and that's about Creep. You know, that's about actually that song being this thing that they're shackled with that they don't want, and so they were constantly trying to get away from that. And I think what's interesting on OK Computer is Fitter, Happier. Just that, and it's that point where I think the Kid A era sort of begins, because they're doing something that's very different, and there's a beautiful melody underneath it. So it's almost like there's this sort of concealed melody, you know, and it's a bit pretentious, and it's, you know, it's like the beginning of what Kid A would become. And I think at that point they became much more sophisticated with Kid A and Amnesiac, you know.
I have no problem with pretension at all. You know, we are all just actors, whether you're a musician or whatever.
Yeah.
I can remember reading an interview with them when OK Computer was really big. It's probably the NME, because I just, you know, that was the way I consumed stuff in the 90s. And Johnny Greenwood saying, there's not going to be any guitars on the next album. The interviewer was like, oh, yeah, cried. And he's like, no, not if we can help it. And to have that breakthrough guitar album, because OK Computer still is a guitar album, to have that breakthrough album, then in an interview you're going, yeah, we're not going to use guitars on the next. That's so cool.
Was that King of Limbs then, when they said that?
I don't know.
Because that was weird and unlistenable album, King of Limbs.
I think there were guitars on the next album, but as a bold statement of intent, that's great.
Yeah.
It's like Suede did it with their second album, because they recorded the second album, then Bernard Butler left, and they got Richard Oakes, really young guitarist. He was like 17 at the time. And Mark Radcliffe was interviewing Brett Anderson. He said, "Well, if you're just taking on random people now, I've got a cousin who's an oboe player and somebody else who plays tenor recorder." And Brett Anderson's like, "Seriously, send them over."
Mm.
He said, "But you're a guitar band." He's like, "Well, at the moment." And I thought, that's cool. Oh, they are. I like Suede. They are 100% a guitar band. Yeah. It's just, absolutely. Right. That was another really intellectual choice.
Oh, sorry. I mean, you can shed those restrictions, can't you?
Mm.
I think I just said King of Limbs was unlistenable. I feel a bit bad for saying that, but it's hard. That's a hard album by Radiohead. That's one of the second from last one that they did. And it's really worth listening to something on YouTube, which is the basement sessions of that album, because the album itself is deliberately, it's so dense. It's so hard to, if you listen to it on a car stereo, unless you've got a really good system, it's unlistenable. It just doesn't work on my car stereo anyway. But there's a basement session of it, and it's with real instruments, and it's not as electronic, and it's really good. And you realize how beautiful the album actually is, but they almost concealed these songs under these sounds. And so you have to sort of delve a bit deeper sometimes with Radiohead to realize what they're doing, how sophisticated they are as a band,
I think bands that have albums that in their lineup that are challenging are generally more interesting to me.
Yeah,
I don't want anything that's cookie cutter. Don't want anything that's churned out.
But I like playing people those stuff, Temporary Secretary by Paul McCartney. Mm. I love playing that to people because it's just,
it's great.
It's ridiculous, isn't it? It's absolutely ridiculous that's Paul McCartney. But I find that interesting.
He's still really proud of it. He was chatting about it on, I can't remember what I saw him on, and he was like, "It's great." He said, "I had a lot of fun making it, and it sounds like it.
You can tell,
right. So your choice has been brilliantly, intellectual, and you've had a lot of stuff. So my next choice, this is a band I think changed genre during the song. Oh, that's a cave-in, the song Trepanning. And they started off, this is no intellectualizing here. They started off late 90s as a straight-edge hardcore band. And around the period of this song, the singer stopped just doing the hardcore vocals and started actually singing, a guy called Stephen Broderick. And then after this album, they kind of went on hiatus. They didn't really split up. They kind of went on hiatus for various reasons. And all the members all went off and did stuff completely and utterly different to the sound of the band. And they came back together a little while ago and have started making new music. And it's such an abrupt change of style to in two albums go from straight edge hardcore to that, which just suddenly is a lot more open and a lot more experimental and interesting.
I think there's something about survival there, isn't there? If you're in a band and you're playing the same stuff and you're restricted, it's very hard to survive. It's very hard to continue that. But if everyone's trying to enjoy what they're doing, whatever way possible, you can survive and adapt and evolve,
We're in a very, I'm certainly in a very privileged position that I can sit here and I'm not really passing judgment, passing comment on bands. But the reality of bands, especially now where it's harder to make money, they are writing songs and playing them 200 times a year. I think bands now probably have to evolve just for their own sanity.
Yeah.
Otherwise, no one's going to do it. You're just going to get so sick of it.
The discipline that bands must have, when you see Metallica playing Seek and Destroy, and they look like they're playing it for the first time, you just think, I don't know how they have that level of discipline. It's amazing, actually. Mm. I mean, it's probably bullshit. They're probably inside thinking about what they're going to do at the weekend or whatever. But there's well, maybe they are enjoying it. I think sometimes maybe they're just simply enjoying the response from the crowd, because I imagine that must be a drug in itself.
Yeah, I can't imagine that gets old. You know, that can't.
And they're probably on autopilot, aren't they? Just playing without thinking, you know, just enjoying that feeling, you know.
I think the money gets to a point where the money just doesn't matter anymore.
Yeah. Well, they could have retired 30 years ago, couldn't they?
Speaking of Suede, their first album, they won the Mercury Music Prize, which was like 20 grand. And an interviewer asked Brett Anderson what you can do with the money. He said, we've already given it to, it was like a teenage cancer charity. And he's like, I grew up on a council estate in a flat. Yeah. My dad never had more than £100 in the bank. The fact that I'm a professional musician, we don't aspire to buy Ferraris. You know, there comes a point where you're like,
the amount of sort of autobiographies I've read, and it's so often the case, and people come from whatever background they come from, they'll buy a mansion and then end up in one room with the curtains drawn,
really?
Playing a guitar and smoking cigarettes and having a drink. And it's just like, it's all completely irrelevant. They just want to be in that place. You know, they just want to experience that. I totally get that. You know, I don't have any ambition really in terms of anything, because if I sit and play a guitar, it's like, that's kind of enough, really. I don't really, at that point, need anything else, you know.
I'm going to play your next track, and it's one that I'm really glad you chose, because it galls me. We've only got a relatively short amount of time left, because this person is someone that I could probably talk about or learn about, because I don't know a lot about. I'm just going to play it. So much. So just tell us about that.
It's The Drift by Scott Walker. And
what
I don't know what
to
say about it. Basically, Scott Walker started off in the Walker Brothers, and it's kind of pop 60s pop music. I guess I was just thinking about the sort of genre that it'd be associated with. And you would say 60s pop, very listenable in everybody's living room, you know, very mainstream and very nice. And then his solo work, each album was like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and each one became a little bit kind of weirder, I think. And then he did Tilt, which is pretty odd. And then he did Drift, which is the darkest album I think I've ever heard. It's just, and the cover of it is just black. And it's just, I think some of it has a, he got a boxer to punch a pig carcass or a cow carcass or something?
Yeah, it was a side of meat or something, wasn't it?
Yeah. And he did the album that I really like by Scott Walker is Scott Walker Sings Jacques Brel, which is cover versions of Jacques Brel songs done in English. And it's got Amsterdam on it, and it's a Jackie. There's some other, some sort of hits on there of his. That's a really good out. It's a really interesting out. And his delivery on that is absolutely superb. It's second to none, you know.
There's so much to like with Scott Walker, and I don't know a lot of his stuff, but we've talked about him on the podcast before. I'll tell you very quickly an anecdote. Sam, who's the usual co-host with this, he got really into Scott Walker, and he bought, I think it was The Drift. And he said there were bits of it that are quite quiet and very, very minimal. And he was sat on a train. He's like, he said, like, you lose a certain amount of music when you listen on the train. So he gave this song about 10 minutes, and he was like, I'm going to have to just skip it because I'm just not hearing it. And he looked down and the CD, they used to break. Can you remember? They used to go, chicka, 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 chicka,
yeah,
chicka,
yeah,
chicka.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, it's not how the song's supposed to sound at all. It's just the CD malfunctioning.
Yeah.
There's so much to like about Scott Walker. You know, David Bowie, arguably based a lot of his sound on Scott Very Walker. He did an album with Sunno, which is just insane. Yeah. But yeah, thank you for bringing that up.
David Bowie covered My Death, which was Scott Walker's version of a Jacques Brel song. And so Bowie, you can really hear Bowie's delivery was influenced by Scott Walker, very much so. Anthony Newley, Bowie is very much a mashup. You know what I mean? Really. Yeah,
well, the last Bowie album, I can remember it came out because it came out just, he like died like days later, I think, wasn't it? It was soon. I remember it was a band practice, and one of my bandmates said, well, he's achieved what he always wanted to do. He's made the perfect Scott Walker album, which is probably bleak, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a bleak final album. Yeah.
Yeah.
But Scott Walker, there's something about, I remember, it's not an album I listen to. It's not an album I ever listen to, really. I think I first heard it maybe 20 years ago. And I remember hearing it and a physical response happening, which I found very interesting. So listening to it in the dark with headphones on, there's very much a physical response to it and an anxiety to it something about sensations, which I really experienced from it, deeply uncomfortable. And he spoke about, I saw an interview with him about it, saying he's always had night terrors. And that's something that I used to have them all the time. And I don't know whether that helped his night terrors or not, because it's something that I found personally is engaging with art, like the drawings that I do, has helped night terrors. And it's like, since I've done them, my night terrors have kind of almost all but disappeared. And I'm wondering if there was a sense of him putting that into musical form. And it does sound like a night terror. So it's very uncomfortable to listen to, for me, I found. So I could sort of connect with that. And I don't know if it's a pleasurable experience, but it's an experience, you know, it's a real experience. And the fact that he was this pretty boy pop singer and gradually just mutated into this gothic, I don't know how you describe it, just so authentic. You know, you look at something like Marilyn Manson and you go, well, that's theatrical, that's a play, you know, that's an act, really, you know. And Scott Walker, you just think that's the real deal. He really is somewhere else. He really is in some sort of nightmare, you know. And I find that really interesting. The authenticity of it, I find really interesting.
So polar opposite that is something very frothy like this.
Sorry, but I don't understand. The things you say, they make no sense at all. Funny, but I think that you mean them all this time, don't you? I know that you think I'm a fool.
Which one is that? What's the chorus to that?
I think I'm a fool, don't you? I think that is the chorus. I think I played a bit of the chorus.
Yeah, oh, right, okay. I mean, I recognise it. I know it's Blur. I know it's like an early Blur one, isn't it?
Yeah, first Blur album. And looking back, I genuinely wonder whether they made that album just to get signed to move on to other things.
But so much baggier than anything else, isn't it? The Hacienda kind of sound.
Oh, it's such a pastiche. Even like There's No Other Way has got that drum loop type thing on it. But at the time, I had no idea about Pink Floyd or any of the Kinks or anything other than like the real big hitters. And I can remember there were some reviews when There's No Other Way came out saying they're ripping off See Emily Play by Pink Floyd. And my dad had a copy of Rumours. Not Rumours, Relics, right. By Pink Floyd. And I can remember like, okay, well, I'm going to go and see what that sounds like. And then, you know, the next track on, or it went on to Interstellar Overdrive, and I was like, wow, what's this? This is brilliant. And then discovered all this other stuff. And then the second Blur album, after the first Blur album, Damon Albarn being interviewed, said, we're done with that indie shit, we're gonna sound like the Kinks now. And we were like, well, who the hell are the Kinks? And he talked about Village Green Preservation Society and Arthur, so we went and listened to those albums and went, holy shit, these are absolutely amazing. So, yeah, it wasn't a deep intellectual choice, other than, you know, they did a very much an indie, schmindy first album and then had a second album which bombed, which I think makes a lot of bands much better if the second album bombs.
It does, but I saw an interview with him relatively recently, and he said if they did that now, if they did that second album, it wasn't Modern Life is Rubbish, was it the second
album? Yeah, yeah, Modern Life is Rubbish, yeah.
He said if they did Modern Life is Rubbish now as a second album, the record company would have dropped them. But obviously the record company, they convinced them to fund Park Life, and then they had the biggest hit, you know, imaginable. So it's interesting that wouldn't, now a record company would just be like, well, you've blown it on your second album, see you later, and you wouldn't get Park Life. You wouldn't get that huge album, you know.
I think it was quite close to the line whether they got dropped or not. Second album, it was Food Records, which was an imprint of EMI. And at the time, Food said, they presented the album and Food said, where's the single?
Yeah.
They said, well, we've made this, not quite a concept album, we've made this perfect piece. And they said, you write a single or we're not putting it out. Mm. So they went away and wrote For Tomorrow, which was a very minor hit, you know, late 20s in the top 50 probably, or top 40. And then bizarrely they put out Pop Scene just as a one-off, which before, I can't remember if that was before or after Modern Life is Rubbish. And then the label was not happy and they were like, look, it's getting close to the end of the road here. And allegedly they said, right, listen to this demo, and it's a demo for Girls and Boys. And Food went, we'll put this out on a single and we'll see how you do. And of course that did very well. And then Park Life came, and then
I think Pop Scene came out the same time as Smells Like Teen Spirit, didn't it? I'm sure that came out at the same time.
Probably very close.
That was what they said was the issue. It came out with Smells Like Teen Spirit. Just eclipsed everything, didn't it? That song, you know.
I loved that song. We saw, me and my friends, who I was in a band with at the time, I was like 15 or 16, we saw them play it live. We got free tickets to see them do a warm-up show because they played it on The Word. And the warm-up show was the Waterfront in Norwich the night before. Mm. And that's just still one of the best gigs ever, because early Blur gigs, people sort of forget that early Blur gigs were rough.
Yeah.
They were, you're crushed half to death, everyone jumping up and down. And the Waterfront's got a really low ceiling, so the sweat would be pouring off it and dripping through the lights. And they were such an exciting band. And then they released Country House.
But I was thinking about things to choose for this, and I did think of my favorite Blur album, which is 13, and that probably may have been one of the next choices, but Trim Trab might have been the choice, because it's such a heavy song, it's such an intense song, and it's so far away from what Blur were. I mean, he's screaming in it, you know, the guitar is so heavy, and I love it when bands go heavy and they're not metal, you know, when they go heavy and it's like it's using heaviness and using that dynamic in a way which is maybe hasn't been done before in that particular way, or it's just a bit more interesting, you know, with melody or whatever, you know.
I'm always interested in people who aren't dressed in metal gear playing metal. That Cave-In, that band that I played earlier, I went to go and see them because I wanted to see the support band. The support band was a band called Pelican, who are heavy as hell, wearing T-shirts and jeans. And I don't know what it is. For some reason, that's always really, really interesting to me.
Yeah, it moves away from the cliche, doesn't it, that you have to dress. The tribalism in music, I think, I find it really stifling, and I find it really uninteresting that people are just, you know, if you're stuck in that particular place and you can't do anything about it, and there are rules applied, and there's a uniform applied to it. I find that really restrictive. As a creative person, I don't like that at all. I don't like anyone imposing any rules on that.
I don't consider myself to, like, aesthetically, visually, no one knows what my music taste would be. They probably think I don't even like music. So it's sort of past people in the streets, and if they're wearing like a really obscure band T-shirt, I always sort of, obviously my stare lingers, because you're like going, wow, I haven't seen that Crass T-shirt for years. Yeah. But they're probably looking at me going, who's that middle-aged man staring at me? Like, you know, they've got no idea. Yeah. It's not like I've got tattoos.
It's kind of covert, isn't it? I quite like that.
Covert extreme music.
Yeah, that's nice.
Right, I'm going to play your next choice, which I love. Dark in the bay. Fucking love that. Beautiful. The whole album this is on. Who was that?
The Doors. That's off the Soft Parade album, Running Blue. And it's just, yeah, I mean, The Doors for me are probably out of my top favorite bands of all time. The Doors always, you know, they're sort of, they're a band that I, you know, when people say, what's your favorite film? I always have like Texas Chainsaws floating around. And it's like that with The Doors. They're a bit like, well, The Doors, obviously, they're kind of, there's something about them that I can't believe that those people are making that sound. And it's quite mystical to me
that
existed. And within 5 years, the amount of genres they covered and the amount of music they made, and John Densmore on drums is just godlike, you know, incredible.
They're a phenomenal band. I mean, when the Oliver Stone film came out, me and my bandmates got one of our dads to hire it, because I think it was a 18.
Yeah.
Oh, excuse me. And we watched it and just became completely besotted. Absolutely, like, yeah, this is so good. And I think it's the point they make in that film is kind of like John Densmore, Robbie Krieger, and Ray Manzarek probably wouldn't have got signed if they didn't have, you know, if they didn't have Jim Morrison up front, because they were astonishing musicians, but they were just astonishing musicians.
Yeah.
You needed that kind of just wild spirit up front. But this album in particular, I'm trying to look up what the order of the albums is, because there's one album where Jim Morrison, I think, was not really on it and not really all that together.
I think he was a bit of a mess on this one. I think this was the third from last.
Third from last.
I think, or maybe the second from last.
The third from last. It was Soft Parade. Yeah, but it's like
Morrison Hotel and then L.A. Woman, I think.
I love L.A. Woman. So Soft Parade, this is bonkers. Compare this to like modern bands. Soft Parade released July 21st, 1969. The next album, Morrison Hotel, February 1970. It's like less than six months apart.
It's ridiculous what they did in such a short period of time. It's baffling, really.
Because Morrison perhaps wasn't quite so in touch with what was happening in the band, the Soft Parade to me is, it feels like the album where the band just went, look, we're fucking good musicians, we understand arrangement,
I think it's mainly Robbie Krieger's writing. I think it's mostly his compositions on this. But that song in particular, again, it's not my favourite Doors album. Waiting for the Sun, I would say, is my favourite consistently from start to finish. But the Soft Parade, it's so interesting. And that counts for a lot for me. It's their Sandinista. It's the one that I listen to and I just... And Running Blue goes through... I mean, it just goes through so many genres. And Robbie Krieger's singing it in this weird little sort of country voice. And it almost goes a bit hillbilly at the end, and it starts off with like this chanting, and it just goes everywhere,
pretty little girl with a red dress on, poor old is dead and gone, and then it's off. Yeah. It's like they pull the ripcord, it goes and everywhere. Off it goes,
and that bit where the brass comes in, it's just a joy. It's just such a joy.
The brass on this album is astonishing, and I'm going to look up after we finish recording what crew it was or who did it, because I bought this album, I spotted it in Out Time Records in Ipswich, secondhand record shop, and sort of knew, we'd seen the film and we knew the first album, we knew the hits as it were, and then I remember getting home and literally putting the needle on the record and the start of this album just goes and like it's straight off the bat, like
so
full horn section.
The whole thing is so over the top and I love it for that, you know.
Yeah, in the most glorious way. Yeah, I'm I don't meet a lot of people who like the Doors, and they're not perfect. There is some sketchy stuff, but I really like the trajectory of the band, because by LA Woman they'd chilled again. They'd sort of found their feet, and they'd had a bassist who was going to join the band, and they'd sort of really. The album after that should have been really good if it had Jim Morrison.
They just sort of chilled out right at the end. They were just like, just do some blues and just chill it all out and just play, you know. But I think the end, if you think of the debut album, the end as a piece of music, for me, that is, I can't quite comprehend how four people can be in a room, create that, be so focused. I mean, it's like listening to sort of the John Coltrane band or something, where you have that level of focus within a unit. Mm. There aren't any overdubs. There's none of that stuff going on. It's just so focused and so atmospheric. And it's like a perfect piece of art, really, the end. You know, I don't think Soft Parade has that. I don't think Soft Parade has that type of thing.
I don't think you can call it a piece of art.
I just think it's a fascinating document. And like Wishful Sinful is absolutely beautiful. You know, there's some beautiful music on there, you know.
It's got some fairly awful bits on it, though, which I'd be fascinated to know why they left them in. So Dawn Parade, sorry, an old Berry band, Soft Parade, it's got some proper drunken.
I was in that band. I was on bass.
No, were you really?
Everybody in Berry was.
Everyone
in that
was.
Band.
It's like the Fall in Berry St. Edmunds.
Yeah, we've all been in that band.
Like doing national service if you're in a band in Berry St. Edmunds, you've got to be in Dawn Parade. Yeah. But there's some real drunken vocals on that. Like,
his crooning is not.
He's just pissed.
Yeah,
and I've always wondered, was that the best performance they could get? Or were, I doubt the band or the producer was going, we're going to leave that in and it's going to be like a wake-up call. I can't believe they thought that. Jim's going to listen to that and go, oh, shit, what have I done on this platinum-selling album?
But I love the story around that. Do you know what I mean? There's such a dramatic rise and fall, isn't it? And just the story of Jim Morrison, and it's mythical, isn't it? You know, and I find that really interesting. That fight, and just the fact it's 5 years, I can't get my head around it. It's like the Smiths, really. When I think of what the Smiths did musically within 5 years, the amount of songs they created and what they did, it blows my mind, really, that anyone can do that within such a short period of time. You know, to be on a roll like that, you know, it's amazing.
And to progress so quickly. Because there's Soft Parade to Morrison Hotel. I don't know Morrison Hotel so well, but Soft Parade to LA Woman, just in terms of production, is LA Woman sounds like a modern production.
Yeah.
It absolutely sounds like it was made in a modern studio with Pro Tools and whatever. Yeah. It's so immaculate. So we're going to have to move on to my last choice, which again is another, it's very on the nose for started in one genre and grew out of it. Do you know who that was?
Nice. No, I do not.
Beastie Boys.
Okay.
So Beastie Boys with Sabrosa. And it's a track that got me to really readdress who the Beastie Boys were. It's an album track. And I chose it because I have just seen the documentary. But they said that basically the first album, they went off to support Madonna on tour. They got back and Rick Rubin just went, here's your album. You know, and it was Fight for Your Right to Party, which they said, you know, they recorded as like a piss take. They were like 16, 17. They recorded as a piss take of like frat boy sort of stuff. And it became like the frat boy album, and which is why the second album, when it came out, just bombed because people wanted Fight for Your Right to Party again. And I think they escaped what would have been a very tight, horrible genre of being frat boy rap by making an album that didn't sell. And the time that In Utero came out by Nirvana, I read a review saying, ah, right, Nirvana are trying to do a Beastie Boys. They're trying to do a second album that's going to tank to give them freedom. And of course, it didn't tank at all. But I chucked that in there because the Beastie Boys, much like Radiohead, actually, there's a lot of variety and there's a lot of stuff. I think weirdly with the Beastie Boys, I don't know why they always seem to have chosen hip hop for the singles, and they're strong singles, but the albums have got so much else on, because they were
musicians as well, weren't they? They weren't just MCs; they were actually
guitarists,
and bassists, and drummers, and things, weren't they?
Well, what happens? They started off as a hardcore band and couldn't really play. That first album is just their voices. It's not anything else. I don't think they play on anything. It's got like Kerry Keane from Slayer on Fight for Your Right to Party. Yeah. Second album, they used a production crew, so they were sort of doing a few bits. Third album, they went, right, we're going to lock ourselves away and learn how to play properly. And that's exactly what they did.
Sabotage, when did that come in? Was that on that? Was that that year?
Oh, yeah, no, Sabotage, they were fully fledged musicians by then. And again, I never knew, but there's loads of clips of them playing Sabotage live on YouTube. And it's bass. Gratitude's the other song that changed my mind on Beastie Boys, because they're all playing instruments. And I've got nothing to get. I fucking love hip hop. Beyond not having a problem with people who just really good MCs, because that's a hell of a skill in its own right.
Skill on its own, yeah.
But I just never realised what a broad package the Beastie Boys are. Right, we have run massively over time, but fuck it. It's not like we've got any reason to really worry about that. This has been an absolute joy, and thank you very much for being a guest. We'll put links to your Instagram and anything else you want in the show notes. Is there any parting thought you'd like to leave the audience with?
No, it's been fun. I've enjoyed it. I've never done a podcast. I mean, I sometimes do sort of videos of things on my page, where I ramble about stuff, but it's nice to have the to-ing and fro-ing, as opposed to me just prattling on about something on my own.
Cool. Right. Right. Thanks to all our listeners. Thanks for listening. And thanks to all the new subscribers we've got recently. I really, really appreciate that. It makes a hell of a difference to us. This is episode, I think, 87. So it's good to stick around, and please do stick around. Right. I'm going to say goodbye. I've been Andrew Culture, and this has been Jago. I'm going to say goodbye. Do you want to say goodbye?
Thank you very much. I feel like I should have some parting words.
Well, like thought for the day on Radio 4 or something.
I hope that the discussion around this in some way inspires people to listen to stuff that's maybe a little bit different, maybe. Because I think there's a culture maybe of albums not being as popular as they were. Do you know what I mean? I like to listen to an album from start to finish, and for that to be a bit of a journey.
Yeah.
And I think maybe that it would be nice if that was still encouraged,
Right. I think this episode will inspire people to do that, and I think this episode will also inspire people to grow out of the genre their bands are in. And with that, I am going to say goodbye.
Just try anything. Try anything and just record anything. You know what I mean? Just do whatever. That's what you got to do, isn't it?